So in this tutorial, I'm going to show you how you can combine two different terrains and have it look seamless. So here we have a nice mountain, and next to it is a ridge, and then there's a general, what I would like to call a floor for the terrain. And they are developed separately, and then you put them together and make it look like it's part of the same thing. And so the way we do it is, first let's start with a mountain. And so there's our simple mountain. It's nothing special. In fact, it's a bit unrealistic. There are several clean lines at the edges. So we displace it a bit to kind of break up some of those cleaner lines. And then we apply erosion. This is just simple erosion, nothing special. And so it starts adding more natural shapes to that mountain and starting to look better. But right now it's a bit like Matterhorn almost. It's too sharp. So then we apply fold to this. And so with fold, it'll take this terrain and create these nice folds on it, which is something that does happen in nature. So I'm going to just move the lighting around so you can see what it's creating. And so first of all, it's toned down the height of our terrain, and it's creating these stratified, slanted slabs of material that create this terrain. So we're kind of getting the best of both worlds. Now it may feel like we're wasting our time eroding this because, well, there really isn't much of erosion going on here. But I highly recommend eroding the terrain beforehand, because those shapes, the little flows and gullies and so on, do contribute to the fold node. So if you were to do it just on the displaced mountain, it would look significantly different and not that cool. So here you can see some of the gullies created by the erosion flow are here. And those are all, you know, not exactly as visible in the erosion node, but with fold, they are contributing to the shape and making it more complex and more layered and better looking. So then, we do something slightly different that you normally wouldn't. And in another video, I talked about this. It's called creating a little orphan, an intentional orphan node, which is where you don't take the main output of something like we do for almost all of these nodes. Like whether we use the secondary output or not, we always end up using the first output and carry it forward. Well, you don't have to. And I'm going to show you how we do it in this case. So first, to our fold output, I apply a breaker. And so what breaker does is create these sharp cracks, or rather deep flows in our terrain. And I have used maximum depth, so we get really, really deep canyon-like flow lines. Then you auto-level the break output. I'm gonna turn on the 2D viewport so you can see what that looks like. So this is just the break mask. So it's now telling us about all the little gullies that it's created. And we auto level it so that, and actually you'll notice in auto level, I've used both auto level and logarithmic scaling. So that gives us a hard, or rather a harder, it's not a hard mask. It's like there are soft lines here, but it's hard enough that we can do things with it. And so then when you apply the aperture node to this, you can see we start getting these rounder shapes, and the really thin lines are becoming these pillar-like formations. Then, using shaper, they're modified just a bit. So you can see we are getting more down here. These are the settings I used. It's a local area effect while maintaining all the fine details. And so again, before it was like this. It's not as visible in the 2D view as it's in the 3D view. So we get a bit of the floor. We collapse some of the sharper things down here. And then we apply a recurve on this. And in this, the duration is a bit high. And the scale is also much higher than default. And then we're also displacing the output down here in the post-process stack. So instead of having to add another node, we just need simple displacement to break up the smoother shapes of recurve. And so as you apply the displace, it creates this jagged height field, or rather what would be a modifier rather, because we take this and then we take the original fold and combine the two. And when we do this, we use the multiply method and a little bit of like a quarter ratio of this. You can experiment to find the right amount. And so what's happening is, if you look here, all the cracks and other things that we created, like this is the normal fold. When you multiply it out of it, it's kind of working like a slight subtraction, but at the same time, it can also multiply, so it can go higher than your original height field, which subtract wouldn't. And so when you do that, you can see some of the parts go down, other parts go up, and then all the slanted, the strata that we created in fold have been augmented with these sharper shapes that we created by using recurve. And so if I go here, you can see these are the shapes being created by recurve, and then we multiply and it affects this existing fold. So I'll turn this off because that's no longer necessary. And so here you can see this side doesn't get affected that much, except the height coming down here and a slightly sharper peak gets modified. But then here we get this beautiful character on the terrain and some here as well. So where the normal fold becomes slightly identifiable after you use it regularly, with this you can create a little variations on it that really set it apart. So I'm just going to change the lighting a bit so you can see like these slightly perpendicular slanted shapes or terrain folding that this is created for us. So again, going back to fold, we have this. It's nice, but it's nothing really fancy. And so here you can see both sides of the fold. And so if we do the combine, then we start getting this nice character. Then we erode it again. And you can see it's creating a nice, more believable shape. And then we create the floor. So the floor is created from an igneous node. It's a simple primitive that creates this shape. And I didn't really choose this for any specific reason. I just played with a few different seeds and this looked nice because it sat right next to the this mountain. So you take igneous and then erode that as well. And so this is important. You want to erode both parts separately first, so they both get to have their own individual character. Then you combine it, and in this, while you're combining it, you use the method max with 100% ratio, so they both get a proper representation and they poke through one another. And so here you can see where that's happening. So this is the seam for the terrain. If you turn on the separation mask in this in the combine node, you can see it. That's where the two different terrains are merging, and that's the big problem sometimes. So now you go and create a mask, and you just mask out the outlines. You just, you know, feed it the combine, so you get this here, and just draw around, and you're done. And so you take that and you apply that as an area mask in erosion and set the area effect to precipitation amount. So what this does is, this mask is the only place where precipitation or rainfall happens, which then initiates erosion. And so the erosion that starts here doesn't end here, but it only starts here. So the rest of your terrain remains mostly unaffected. So if I go back, you can see the peak, these lines here, all of that remains the same. But then when you combine this, you can see this, there's an extra bit of flow happening, and the seam that we saw here is no longer there. And for all intents and purposes, this looks like a terrain that could have been created from a single source. And that's exactly what you want. Now you can take this and then add data maps and texture nodes and color nodes, and you can create all sorts of textures for this. Now let's say after you combine this, if you wanted to move the mountain, That is possible. So for that, what we're going to do is before we combine it, we're going to apply the transform node. Now, it's important that if you're moving something with the transform node in this scenario, that it have tapered off edges. If you have something higher up, it becomes more difficult to move it. So to the erosion node, I'm going to apply the transform node. Let me pull it up here. I'm going to put that into the combine. And so if I go back to the combine node, and I'm going to right click and select pin, so I can see the end result, and then going to transform, I can now start repositioning my mountain. So I can move it here, or I can move it there. Or maybe that's a bit too much. Let's move it to the other direction. And then there. That could look cool. And you can see the seam has also moved. So to make this work, I would have to go back here. And then this doesn't work. So I have to go edit. And first I'll delete the existing mask. And then we can make a new one looking at the seam that's coming up now. And this side doesn't really matter, so we can leave it alone. Close it, it gets updated, and then the new erosion happens. And now that's also part of the same terrain.